Please welcome James Wester, IDC, Ola Duden, BitOasis, Pablo Gonzalez, Bitso, Ben Gorlick, Blockstream, Sunny Ray, Unicoin, and Marcus Swainpool, BitX.
Hi there. Welcome to Digital Currencies and Emerging Markets. I have one housekeeping note. Proof of work finalists, you need to go to 7 and meet Ryan. If there's anybody in here for proof of work, you are to be on 7. I am James Wester. I am really delighted to be here. I had a conversation before this with most of the panelists, and a couple of things became quite apparent to me. One is, I suspect I'm going to very quickly lose control of this panel, which is going to be okay. And number two, I think it's going to probably be most of them talking to each other, which again, is okay. We do have a Q&A scheduled. It's a part of the panel, but if you want to use Slido, I have the tablet. I will be looking at those. Please feel free to ask questions. I have a feeling this will be a fun topic. And it'll be more fun if you actually want to participate. So it is on financial inclusion. Financial inclusion is one of those things that has been a relatively intractable problem for many, many years. We've got about 2 billion consumers worldwide who don't have access to basic financial services. We have made some progress over the last 5 years. We've seen that number come down from about 2.5 billion to 2 billion. But I've got some very smart people who would like to talk about how Bitcoin and blockchain can possibly address that. So what I'd like to do is now turn it over to my panelists. Why don't you give me sort of a quick thumbnail of you, your name, your company, and why you're up here and talking about Bitcoin, blockchain, and the unbanked.
Great. My name is Ola Duden. I'm co-founder and CEO of BitOasis. We are a Bitcoin wallet and exchange based in Dubai, but we have an outlook to emerging markets. So we currently serve Middle East and North Africa. That's our main market. Our exchange is open in 5 countries, more now in Gulf regions, but obviously we'll be expanding across the whole region as well. Why we're doing it in the Middle East, I think it's a fast-growing emerging market, but is underserved when it comes to financial services. So you're talking about a region that has probably around 80% of adults don't have access to financial services, and then the economy is made up of around sort of 80% small and medium enterprises that operate in the informal economy and don't have access to financial services as well. So, you know, you're not just talking about consumers, you're talking about consumers, businesses across the board that don't actually have sufficient access to financial services. So it's a huge opportunity for us. Why Bitcoin blockchain? I think everyone has the reasons why that. It's because it's an opportunity to create a global kind of payment rail and global access to financial services and connect those people who don't have access to financial services to a global kind of market transactional payment system that will bring them online and become sort of potential consumers and potential active basic participants in the economy. So I would say that is it in high level, but I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Excellent. Pablo.
Great. I'm Pablo Gonzalez. I'm co-founder and CEO of Bitso. We're a Bitcoin exchange and wallet in Mexico. What we're doing is we're connecting the traditional financial system in Mexico with the world of digital currencies. So maybe most of you don't know, but Mexico has one of the best interbank payment systems in the world. It's pretty much instant, and we're connected to it like a bank. So it allows us to do really interesting things when putting it together with, let's say, Bitcoin, right? So that's what we're focusing on. It's on getting financial access to global financial access to Mexicans using these two, the existing infrastructure combined with the new world of finance. And why am I doing this? Because I live in Canada for 12 years and I was working on some Bitcoin projects over there, and I realized that emerging markets are the ones that can take more advantage of this technology than first world countries. So for me, the possibilities in Mexico in terms of cross-border payments, in terms of financial inclusion later on, there's a lot of different things that are really interesting for the region. So I think I can do a little bit for my country by pushing Bitcoin locally.
Excellent. Ben.
Hi, Ben Gore, Director of Products for Blockstream. Blockstream has been developing sidechains, an extension to the Bitcoin open source project. This is an interesting topic because, in my view, one of the biggest problems that the world faces is the gap in commerce between people, also the gap in languages spoken around the world. If you want to really be able to cross that divide, you have to solve both problems. The ability for emerging markets to adopt the technologies seems to be faster, as Pablo is describing. I think that the need is greater, and it's obvious and apparent. People are trying to send money to their families, they're trying to help loved ones, there's all sorts of great applications for it, and yet it's very hard. I think that Blockstream as a company has a vision for being able to create fungibility. You want to be able to have the ability to exchange assets, go anywhere in the world, be able to spend your money, be able to feel like your money is your money. And also have privacy, because people have human rights that are important and has to be valued. So how we build technology and infrastructure to support companies, for example, the Liquid product that we're building, which allows Bitcoin exchanges to be able to do faster settlements between each other, is an example of how that can be extended and applications can be built on top of that, that enables remittances and various other use cases.
Hi, my name is Sunny. I'm the co-founder of UnoCoin, India's leading Bitcoin company. We essentially make it easy for people in India to buy, sell, store, use, accept Bitcoin. So why is India super exciting for our team? Mainly because, well, three reasons. Number one, so you guys probably have heard that Bitcoin's often referred to as digital gold, right? And maybe you don't know this, but Indian women own more gold than the U.S. government. So gold is highly valued, number one. And you couple that with the fact that out of 18 million programmers in the world, 5 million of them live in India. See, digital gold. Second reason, India is the largest inward remitter in the world. Close to $100 billion a year comes into India. And so we think that there's an opportunity here to work with guys like Blockstream and really bring efficiency, make remittance fast and free. And the third reason is that, you know, as we talk about banking the unbanked, India has, last I checked, close to 200 million people that are unbanked. And so we think that Bitcoin presents an opportunity to help there as well. It's not going to happen overnight, but we think it will happen.
My name is Marcus Swanepoel. I'm one of the co-founders and CEO of BitX. We are what CoinDesk would refer to as a universal Bitcoin company, meaning we play across multiple areas of Bitcoin and infrastructure. We run exchanges. We have open APIs that various businesses use, whether we integrate for merchants or potentially for fiat-to-fiat remittances that the remittance companies might use. And we also run consumer apps where people can buy and sell Bitcoin, send Bitcoin or fiat to each other across borders, buy things online, and so on. We operate predominantly across Southeast Asia and Africa, in about eight to 10 countries, depending on which product we're talking about. And I think, you know, for much of the aforesaid reasons, we also think emerging markets are a lot more interesting for the use cases for Bitcoin and cryptocurrency, and that's why we operate predominantly in these markets. And we're based out of Singapore, and we have teams in Jakarta and in Cape Town.
Excellent. So we have a wide representation from different regions, and I guess the big question I have is, because addressing the unbanked and the underbanked has been such an issue for so long, everybody here seems to agree that Bitcoin provides the next opportunity for really being able to address that. Why is that that we think that Bitcoin can do it? Now, you've kind of mentioned a couple of reasons why you think that's the case, but we have mobile money programs, let's say, in Sub-Saharan Africa, like M-Pesa. You've got other issues that have, or other products that have been coming up in other markets. Why do we think that using blockchain or Bitcoin is going to be that tool that actually helps us connect the underbanked? Or is it? Is that not necessarily going to be the case?
And I'm going to I think one thing that we have to be careful of is just to sit here and tell people what they want to hear, because I know what people want to hear. They want to hear that Bitcoin is going to bank the unbanked, it's going to make the world a better place, and it's not going to bank the unbanked. It might in 20 years time bank the unbanked, but we are so far away of using Bitcoin for banking the unbanked. Even something like consumer remittances, which is a very strong narrative that gets perpetuated especially in Western media, how Bitcoin is going to make remittances easier and so on. what we have to realize is that a lot of problems when it comes to banking the unbanked or especially in consumer remittances, your issues are around distribution and customer acquisition cost and education and all this type of stuff. Having a better technology right now doesn't actually make a big difference to that. I mean, it's a small difference, but that's not actually solving the problem. So I think we have to be, you know, very careful how, what we say, because it's easy to say, oh, but when we'll bank the unbanked. Yes, if we all one day use some global financial system or one global currency, it would be a fantastic way to create financial inclusion. But we are very, very far away from that. Most of you will be retired and, you know, on a boat somewhere when we're even starting to touch on that aspect of it. Doesn't mean that there's no, you know, use of it. There's a lot of, you know, stuff we can do to make finance easier and more efficient. But to get to that state where what I think a lot of people are referring to, I think we're very far away.
I'm going
to
jump in, actually, and I do agree with you. Maybe not 20 years. 20 years is a lot, obviously, given the smartphone adoption and internet adoption worldwide. But it will take some time. So obviously, it's not going to happen overnight. And it's not sort of like a lot of the rhetoric mentioned in the media. Eventually, you know, hopefully will be realized, but not as fast as people hope for or, you know, other people in the ecosystem. To break down the points that you mentioned, I think a lot of people have some sort of little understanding of how potentially that ecosystem can grow to support that use case. I think most of us are exchanges or liquidity providers, meaning that we provide liquidity or access to Bitcoin in the ecosystem. But to get to that level to consumer interface, and I do believe the way it's going to be that people aren't just going to buy Bitcoin. People will transact using the technology, but not call it Bitcoin at that point. It's just a faster way and cheaper way to send money. But to get to that point and completely eliminate the whole sort of Bitcoin part, you need obviously the infrastructure, the liquidity provider, which is the stage that we are today, and that is the right step to get to that use case, and then build sort of interface or application layers on top of that, build the right integrations around emerging markets and have the right sort of amount of liquidity and momentum in emerging markets in the Bitcoin ecosystem to get to that use case. But as of today, I think we are in the early stage to realize that. It's not that we're not working on it. We obviously are.
We want it to happen.
But it's going
to
take time.
Well, I was going to say, I'm curious, though, because it's different in Mexico.
I mean, there's a reason why banks haven't been able to bank so many people, right? So it's not all about, you know, how financial inclusion is good. What are the advantages that you're actually bringing to these consumers by being financially included? And some of the things we're doing, like we're seeing, they're very different from the advantages of having a bank account, like the advantages of having access to global capital markets, to be able to get credits from, you know, somebody in China. Those are actual advantages that people are real life advantages, and they're not the disadvantages of, oh, I have a bank account and I have to walk 3 hours to the nearest branch, because not all branches in Mexico, for example, most of the municipalities don't even have a bank. So right now, almost being banked in some of these countries is a disadvantage. So my argument is, you know, when you have mobile numbers, when you have, you know, a country, for example, in Mexico, like 99% of the country has a mobile phone, like, or access to a cell phone signal. So, you know, now they don't need to walk 3 hours to the branch, and they can just transact and have access to the world using Visa and Nexus, right? And not only to the country. So for me, that's an interesting part, and it's not the fact that, you know, like, financial inclusion is good. It's what are the actual products you're giving the people.
Sunny, I'm curious, because it's different in India, because right now there's a massive push in the Indian central bank to begin the process through mobile, through any number of tools. Is it a different perspective from there? I mean, are you...
So I think the initial question was, why do we think Bitcoin and blockchain can potentially bank the unbanked,
right?
Correct? Okay, so the verdict's still out, but, you know, all of us are old enough to have lived through, you know, the internet and mobile phones and all that, and I think it'd be, you know, pretty parallel to say that, you know, blockchain feels, or Bitcoin feels, a lot like those technologies did early on. So at the beginning, it was mostly rich people that bought mobile phones, and then eventually, over time, costs were driven down, and as a result, now, you know, people who make $5 a day in India have mobile phones. So I do think that today, although, you know, if not the banking, the unbanked, I do think that as liquidity grows, I think that as companies like ours focus on, you know, building mobile apps and really trying to address these issues, it will start to get. So we just launched a POS, like a point of sale app, just last week that enables anybody who has a store in India to accept Bitcoin. And what we do is we just, you know, convert the Bitcoin over and send rupees to their bank account. So that's not banking the unbanked, but it is kind of getting a little bit closer towards bringing Bitcoin mainstream. And then there's one other point I wanted to make was regarding remittance. I don't think the Bitcoin exchanges like ours will actually kind of embrace remittance. This is my guess. I think what's actually going to happen in the next few years is you'll probably start seeing Bitcoin disappear into the background more and more, and it'll become kind of like TCP/IP or HTTP. It'll be essentially this protocol in the background. So my dad, let's say in Calcutta, will be able to send $50 to his mom, my grandmother in Kolkata, and she'll just receive 2,500 rupees in her bank account, the click of a button for, again, instantaneously and for free. Neither one of them will know that Bitcoin was used. So we think those types of secondary kind of applications are going to start to emerge more and more.
Okay, so you made actually follow a point. You said there's a reason why banks don't reach a certain number of unbanked. And you actually didn't state what the reason was, but the reason is it's incredibly impossible to make money off of those, and banks are in it to actually make a profit. But the question comes along then, okay, so you're building all of these tools to reach the unbanked. Well, you're not doing it out of the goodness of your heart either. Your companies are actually in business as well. So if you're now providing access, where is the, what's the business case for it? How is it that you're actually going out there and doing this, and instead of doing it as a charity project, you're actually doing it to make money? What is that? What are the products that are being built on top of it? What's the business case here that makes it a good idea for you guys to be doing what you're doing?
Correct. I think what you're saying a little bit is that a lot of the banks, they're not banking these people because they're bad customers for them and they make them lose money. So, and the reason why they make them lose money is because a lot of the processes that they have in place and the legacy processes have stayed the same. So if you can actually make a business model where those people, the underbank, I mean, Mexico has 60% of the adult population is unbanked. We have the same rate as Somalia, for example, which is incredible for a country that's just next to the US, right? And if you can actually make a business case where these businesses actually make money from those customers, for example, we have this thing where you can fund or, you know, you can get access to Bitcoin in 140,000 locations in Mexico. So 7-Elevens, Oxxos, Walmart, all these type of things. And for us, the overhead involved in that, it's super small. So you actually have these banks that are not banks that people can access, and now certainly they have these global financial tools for doing whatever they want that accepts Bitcoin. So the growth of the Bitcoin network globally gives value to what we're doing. So if there's a company like OLAS and somebody, you know, wants to transact in Dubai, then I can, you know, because she exists, it gives more value to my company. So it's very interesting what's happening with Bitcoin, specifically Bitcoin, not blockchain.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, one thing I want to add as well is that, yes, the global nature of the technology allows the creation of new business models and low barrier to entry into financial services. I think what that introduces is an opportunity to look into current regulatory and financial services, like the frameworks in financial services, and introduce a sort of more innovative way to create financial products and new frameworks, regulatory frameworks that would enable other companies as well building on this technology to serve that underserved customer base. So we see it obviously as an opportunity to build new products to serve new customers, be it businesses or enable other businesses also to serve that market segment. But it's also an opportunity to look into new regulatory frameworks that would enable the global nature of the Bitcoin blockchain. And I think that is actually significant, not just obviously in our jurisdiction, but globally, actually internationally as well.
Okay. So one of the questions actually asked by the audience, Joel Carlson asked, banking the unbanked should imply extension of credit. So when we're talking about other products, does that mean we can actually then start giving them access to, say, credit markets, capital markets? You were talking about maybe somebody buying in Mexico, you know, selling in Dubai, but we're also, I'm assuming, saying that we can open this up. Curious if there are other things that are going on in that,
I mean,
in space.
If you create the proper connection with, you know, with digital currencies and the local system, suddenly a company, a group of guys in Sweden that have a really good way to measure if somebody's trustworthy to get credit, they figure out, they do a better way to do it than whatever efforts are happening locally, let the company in Sweden give them credits, right?
Right.
So it's opening these tools to the world. You know, once you're able to create these local bridges, certainly, you know, you can have these fintech companies that are not localized, that are offering other products as an extension.
Okay. So the big word, though, that I've now mentioned, or heard mentioned a couple of times, though, is regulation. This is something that, you know, we'll probably spend the rest of the time talking about, just the regulatory regimes in the different areas and how they are actually looking at not just Bitcoin, but also all types of new tools that are supposed to reach the end of it. And I'm curious, sort of, how are in each of the regions you sort of represent, how are the different regulatory regimes looking at Bitcoin, blockchain, financial inclusion, how are they looking at these tools, and are they providing an opportunity or are they more of a hindrance? And, you know, what do we do to sort of overcome that obstacle? Because I have a feeling it is more of an obstacle than anything else. And I'm going to throw this out, start with you, because we had a conversation earlier, yeah. But yeah, anybody else can chime in as well.
Yeah, so we operate in different countries in the Middle East. Every jurisdiction is actually within the region, has its own unique regulation and view of the technology. There isn't a regulatory framework that exists today. Not in the United Arab Emirates or in Dubai where we're operating. Although recently the Dubai Blockchain Council was launched by the Museum of Future, which is under the Prime Minister's office in Dubai, and one of their sort of mandate is looking into regulation. Now the good thing for us, I think we're probably the only company that was able to actually set up as a Bitcoin company and exchange. Obviously you've got sort of the usual hurdles to set up such a company and, you know, banking relationships and things like that. But Dubai tends to be a very progressive jurisdiction within the region, and they do have sort of like an appetite to innovation, embracing new technologies. So I'm a bit optimistic from that standpoint. But today, you know, there's no regulatory framework. Obviously, there are plans to look into regulations, but nothing at this point that would, I would say, kind of hinders or stop what we're doing. Having said that, obviously, you know, we're very sort of observant of our company practices and when it comes to AML, KYC, and things like that. So we do have all the processes in place, so we do position ourselves as a potentially regulated entity. But today, there is no regulations when it comes to Bitcoin and blockchain.
Is everybody else just as optimistic about regulatory regimes?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Mexico is funny because it generally looks at what the U.S. is doing, probably a lot of countries, and a year or 2 years later, they Google Translate the initiative that was done here and try to adapt it locally. I mean, it's not like that, but it seems that way, right? Like with a lot of the financial regulation initiatives. So, I mean, yeah, we've been going and approaching the regulators, taking leadership on it, but more than anything of what ever happened, because this is a challenge for all these emerging economies. This is a very misunderstood technology, and if you don't have people locally talking to the right people, educating, telling them like, hey, it's not so bad, it's not only used for X, Y, and Z, then the development of that technology can be very negative. So, I mean, that's something we're doing, we're spearheading in Mexico, and we're happy to do it, but it's something that all of us need to do locally, right?
Right.
And that's why you need to have these players.
Yeah, I'm going to jump in at this point. It's pretty difficult to have like a company that is based in the U.S. serving emerging markets. It's a very local, unique adoption case, specifically once you start interfacing with regulations, that you actually need strong teams locally or regionally to be doing that part. It's a very, especially it's emerging technology, right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of market, you know, the education and adoption that needs to happen at a very local level.
Yeah, so I just wanted to share that. So yeah, regulation's a big thing, right? I think when people get into Bitcoin, oftentimes they, you know, get swept away by how cool the tech is. And I think it's important to recognize that if you're going to build a Bitcoin business, even in the absence of, you know, regulation, it's important to recognize that these technologies do pose some sort of existential threat to governments. And it's important, even in this vacuum, it's important for companies to put on their big boy pants and essentially, you
self-regulate in the absence of it. And so I just want to mention a few things quickly. So in India, there's I don't know if anyone's ever heard of Mr. Ravi Ram Rajan. He's the Alan Greenspan equivalent. He's a central banker. The reason I find him to be very interesting is three reasons. Number one, he's an electrical engineer from IIT, and many of you might have heard IIT is super difficult to get into. So he's a central banker that gets math, which is an engineering. Number two, he's from the Chicago School of Thought. So he's a big fan of free markets and less government intervention. And the third thing is he also predicted the financial crisis back before 2007-2008. At the time, he was considered a Luddite. People laughed at him, but eventually people were like, oh, this guy saw the future. So I think that, and so about 6 months ago or so, somebody asked Mr. Rajan on national television, a student asked him, sir, you believe in free markets, so what are your thoughts on free banking, like Bitcoin? And he said, look, I'm paraphrasing, you can Google it, it's on YouTube, but he says, look, there are obviously, there's security concerns, there's volatility concerns, but he goes on to say that he believes that the future of India is one of a cashless society and that some technology like Bitcoin would be at play. And he even has the intellectual foresight to say that, if that day ever came, that central banks would have a very hard time, funding themselves. And so, but he did, then he finished off by saying that that's not a reason for us to resist these types of technologies. We need to embrace them. Maybe we'll figure out some other way of making money, like asking the government. And so I thought that was interesting because even though, in India there's a lot of rules and regulations, and it sounds like it's not the greatest thing, but at the same time there are things that at least give us a lot of hope that big things could happen.
Regulations made by people.
Yeah.
So if you have good people in the right places.
Yeah, and the other thing is also like our law firm, Nishit Desai, he's literally the top techno legal law firm in the country. E-commerce and payment processing in India happened today because of Nishit. Most foreign investments that happened into India today happened because of that law firm. And they actually have a law firm full of engineers and like nanotechnologists and guys and girls that are super technically astute, and then these people become lawyers. And so those are the types of people that are actually helping us. So we have a white paper already. If anyone's interested, I can tell about it after. But we're also working on something much more comprehensive where we get academics, entrepreneurs, and investors, and people from all over the world to kind of help build a regulatory framework for Bitcoin businesses in India.
Very cool. So do you have more to add on the Asian perspective? Or?
No, not much to add. I think we've been pleasantly surprised at how the regulators have developed in this industry. Obviously, similar to the Middle East, it's many different countries, many different people, different type of risk tolerances and rules. One thing that is peculiar about emerging markets that you don't get in a lot of other markets is that the regulators are very concerned about capital controls. I'd say in some countries, even more so than AML and some of the other risks associated with Bitcoin. I think another trend that we've seen is that the regulators it's been a few years of constant engagement to get them on board and understand it better. I think we've gone through a patch now for a while where everything was a bit blockchain, and I think some of them kind of stopped thinking about Bitcoin, thinking it's not really something they have to worry about because the whole world will just be blockchain. And I think some of them are starting to realize now that maybe there's not so much to some of these things, or maybe they can just see it as a normal database and not as a separate currency or separate financial system. So I think it's delayed a lot of thinking for some of the regulators, but some of them are coming back now and asking the right questions, and we've been very pleasantly surprised at how pragmatic they've been. Some of them want to regulate, and some of them have explicitly told us that they're willing to take a more of a sandbox approach and allow you to do certain things up to a certain size of a business and so on. And they're similar to the Delaware initiative that they discussed this morning. It's more let's wait and see what happens, let's observe before we start regulating approach, which is very encouraging.
Yeah, I think in a few years' time, a couple of years, that you'll start seeing more clear positions on regulation for emerging markets, mainly because the Bitcoin ecosystem is actually getting to a phase where, it's early, but the momentum is there, it's definitely growing. And in a few years, you're going to see sort of bigger momentum and more adoption of technology, whether from businesses or consumers. And that's where regulators feel like they need to mobilize and be faster in their responses.
Yeah, one of the things I've been, when I was down in Barbados at the Financial Cryptography Conference, and I had an opportunity to spend a couple of days with the BIT team, which basically they're operating a Bitcoin exchange and really a network down there. And what they were able to do with regulators, I found very impressive. They spent a lot of time with the central bank. They talked to many different jurisdictions throughout the Caribbean. They were able to get the Minister of Finance to understand what they were trying to do for the people in Barbados, that they were trying to make low-cost or free inter-Caribbean payments possible. And then how do you connect the outside world to that? I mean, if you look, and you can see it on the Central Bank of Barbados website, they have real capital controls, even between other islands that are right next door neighbors, right? So being able to move their money from one currency to the next is not easy. In fact, you actually need a foreign exchange account, which requires an enormous amount of paperwork as an individual to be able to do that. So I think that they have done something that's rather remarkable, and I would definitely encourage other companies that are working in the space to talk with the central banks that are in their jurisdictions, because there is value for them. If you think about the way that the model was supposed to work, central banks set up authorized issuers, which we look at as the intermediary banking system, to issue all the money to the people, right? So I could theoretically go to the central bank and say, hey, I'd like to get some money, I'd like to do some banking directly with you, but they said, no, you have to go through this party, and this party won't issue you a bank account. So this catch-22 is a bit of a challenge. I think that's where these companies are really shining.
Excellent. So I'm looking at some of the questions that have been asked, and I think this is interesting considering that we have exchanges, Bitcoin exchanges, and representatives up here. One of the questions is, aren't they beginning to consolidate, and how do you stay in business? And we had a discussion earlier about sort of that connection, and I'm curious how you see all of these different regions, all of these different exchanges that you guys are participating in and running. How do they, what happens next? In other words, I know that you're still in the first stages of building these out. What happens after that? How do the connections work, and what happens to the exchanges themselves when you start connecting?
Yeah, one thing we're actually in the process of doing and have been looking into as a team and talking to other exchanges as well and other companies is basically building sort of like a network of cross-border payments or payment rails, specifically because we think that's a great use case for the market that we're in. Given that businesses and consumers find that, whether you're banked or unbanked, actually find it quite hard to move money cross-border. So we see the opportunity of integrating with other exchanges and other emerging markets to enable that form of use case. And we think that's a big opportunity for us. And obviously that happens by integrating and talking and partnering with different liquidity providers in different places. The other thing as well that I want to note is that we are actually the only exchange in the region that we're operating in, and we're serving a huge demand and sort of all the demands channeled through us. Now, obviously, just being a kind of standalone exchange, there's a point where you need to go further, and I think it's definitely cross-border payments for us. It's building global payment rails and plugging our exchange to that.
Yeah, there's clearly, there's a lot of local challenges, whether it's regulation, whether it's people, marketing, customer acquisition, and there's many things that are very specific for a region. But the great thing about what we're doing is that, we're all speaking the same language, we're all speaking the same protocol. This allows me to connect to some of the other exchanges here in a day without crazy contracts, because we have a trustless way of sending value and receiving value, so we're speaking the same protocol. And for example, with something like Liquid, with Blockstream, we speak the same language and don't even have accents, right? It's even more integrated. So we're gonna see a world where there's these connections between countries are going to start happening. And I think that's when the exciting part really, starts to take off.
Yeah, I was thinking about the timelines. I think about this all the time. I'm much more bullish than the 20 years. I think we're 5 years out from probably over a billion people touching Bitcoin in some way. People don't believe that, but if you look at the rise and growth of social networks, it becomes quite obvious. Three social networks partner with the right companies and you've got a billion people. So what's the obstacle? I mean, you have to demonstrate convenience, value, trustless exchange, privacy. And I think these are we're moving towards that. People are saying we need more privacy. We need to understand that what we're doing is direct with the person we're doing it with. this idea of peer-to-peer payments, this property that Bitcoin is enabling, is really, in my opinion, the future of where all of this heads to. But it takes time, and it takes a lot of hard work, a lot of development cycles, people that have to think through difficult problems that require aligning incentives with technology. I think that's where Bitcoin got it right in its initial how you issue Bitcoin, how you can prove that it's fair in terms of the issuance model, and that continues to extend.
So I'm curious, you actually mentioned the thing we've talked about now, how it's a few years down the line, you're more optimistic, but still we're talking about the things that we need. Throw this out for the panel in general, what, and we only have a few minutes left, so I think it's a good way to kind of conclude it. What near-term steps need to be taken? What is it now that if we're going to start using these things on eventually, financial inclusion, the ability to reach people in developing markets, what's next? What do we need now? We've had some conversations outside about investment, about capital that needs to be provided, regulatory frameworks. What's sort of the big thing that you think, and I guess actually I'll start here, but, you know, what would you like to see? What do you think is necessary to see us kind of go to that next step?
I think it's already happening. It's just basically building a stronger infrastructure to support a Bitcoin ecosystem in those emerging markets. Exchanges, wallets. Exchanges, liquidity, Bitcoin liquidity, easy access to Bitcoin cash in, cash out, payment processors, wallets, secure tools, products, and then obviously those companies having access and the right support, regulation, capital, et cetera, in their own jurisdictions. And then is basically building that tight integration where everyone just talks at the same level, talks at the same protocol. It's already happening. Obviously, it's not something that happens overnight. But I think exchanges, Bitcoin companies in emerging markets have actually got to a level of maturity that they are on the same level and understanding, and that makes it much easier to kind of go to the next level. You didn't see that probably a year and a half ago, a couple of years ago, but now you can definitely see it, definitely.
For me, the big one is use cases, more use cases. Give people value add, real use cases, and then we'll see adoption starting to, and that's happening already, but one more. So.
Well, it gets tougher and tougher, by the way.
Yeah, exactly.
You're going to have to
start with the easy part. It's already happening. And then
by the time we get to you, I'll be curious to find out what that answer is. Good.
By the time we get to him, it's going to be 20 years. 20 years out.
You have to think about the full process from the institution all the way to the consumer. Consumers are looking for convenience, and they're looking for simplicity. So people that are building the interfaces have to be thinking about that. And it's a meaningful thing. It has to look and feel like something that they're comfortable and familiar with already. And it shouldn't be non-intuitive and how to use this. And if I have to sit there and explain it to you, I didn't build it correctly. And I mean, it's different in the B2B market, right? And I think it's easy to confuse the two. Security and trustlessness in the technology and privacy, I think that should be built inherently there. Whether the users have to be educated on that over time, that's going to be the case. But it needs to be there, whether they know about it or not. For people to be able to have a truly strong sense of that the assets that they own are actually in their own possession. That's my opinion.
Yeah, so what's next? Yeah, I guess better, faster, cheaper, all those things. So specifically mobile, we're focusing a lot on that for obvious reasons, because the mobile adoption in India is going up like crazy. The second thing is we're also launching an order book exchange soon. We're also looking at, and we're going to be launching our API. So like I said before, we're really looking at ways of enabling the Bitcoin community, enabling other entrepreneurs to build on top of the infrastructure that we built. And that's really important to us. And I do agree. I think this year, I think Barry said it about 6 months ago that this year would be the year of consolidation. So we're definitely seeing a lot of that. And I just want to finish on one last note is that I think that one thing that's also very unique about India is that our cost base for running our company is probably 1/100th of what it probably costs to run a business in the Valley. So we're able to take a lot of small bets. We're able to do a lot of development really quickly and make a lot of mistakes, but then figure out which products actually had some sort of, you know, market traction or need, and then we kind of dive down on those products. And so we don't know exactly what we're going to, you know, do. Like, we have like 100 different ideas, but we'll figure it out really quickly in terms of which are the ones that are going to be the winners. And we'll double down on that.
All right, Marcus. So since you did start as, you know, with sort of the sobering
reality here. We'll let you you conclude. What do you sort of see as the next thing that's necessary to make us get to that point?
And don't take the 20 years so literally. That's just a euphemism for it will take a long time. I think, you know, I certainly agree with the infrastructure. That's very important for the next phase. The use cases, we're working both those things really, really hard. I think what can be a very important game changer over the next 12 to 15 months is a bit of better coordination for the industry. Mm-hmm. There's a huge amount of duplication of effort going on with people dealing with regulators, trying to educate people. And a lot of it also has to do with just the brand and the reputation of Bitcoin. I think that is still, for many regulators and consumers, there's some really issues around the brand. And if you take the Australian wines for an example, right? Australia, the wine industry is very competitive in the UK, and instead of all the Australian farms competing with each other to advertise in the UK, they just started branding, Australian wines as a brand, and then a lot of the Australian wines, ended up benefiting together. So I think there is an opportunity for the industry to get together and say, look, let's promote Bitcoin as an industry, even allocate some money to it collectively. I know there was someone tried to do it a long time ago. I think that type of coordination to get some of those economies of scale can be very, very powerful for the industry. But, we're going to have to see if that will happen in reality.
Well, one last thing also around the last mile problem, which I think is one of the areas that really affects anybody who's trying to do remittances, is that getting it into the currency that you actually need it in to spend it in the place that you're trying to spend it. This problem could be solved with actions taken by liquidity providers that already are providing liquidity in other markets. I think we're starting to see this technology become better understood by them, and they're starting to step up and say, yeah, we would like to play a part. So early adopters that can provide liquidity, work with companies like these exchanges, that would be probably in their best interest, because otherwise they run the risk of being disintermediated by the technology and by the push outwards of what people are doing.
Excellent. Well, I just want to say thank you very much for my panelists. Thank you very much for being here today. I do appreciate it. And just a round of applause for the folks up here. Thank you.